Stefano Muraro from the University of Delft, the Delft University of Technology in the Netherlands. So Stefano is the lucky winner. And what is this prize about? Well, this prize is 1,000 euro, which these days I don't think it's something we should underestimate. And plus, there is a beautiful parchment, a beautiful diploma that you can frame Stefano and put on your in on the wall in your office. And also, and I think this is the what we are all looking forward to listening. You have the right and the pleasure, I hope, to give a speech to we give you about half an hour for you to present again in half an hour your doctoral work. So you have the floor, and I'm very sorry not to congratulate you in person. I will do it immediately after your talk. Now, for everybody, there are two important details. Detail number one is, as I said already, please mute your microphone. If you have questions, you can also write your question in the chat, and I'll be ready and happy to give you the floor after the talk of Stefano. Or you can just raise your arm, but again, this is in the second part after the talk by Stefano. The second important message is that we are going to record the presentation and the discussion. I hope that there is no problem with any of you in that, but in case there is any problem, you can then write it on the chat and we'll make sure that all the privacy you want and need will be respected. Well, I think it's quite time to start. It's 3:10, so I was not that long. I think that it's time for Stefano to talk. Congratulations again, Dr. Muraro. And Stefano, you have the floor.
Thank you very much. I hope you can see me and hear me well, first of all. And I will also like, first of all, saying thank you for this fantastic and wonderful opportunity. I'm truly pleased and honored to receive this prize and being able to be online with you today to share my PhD thesis that I will proceed in sharing now my screen. So if you can let me know if everything is working, then I will start with the presentation. Can you see my screen?
Yes.
Okay, thank you very much. So the presentation today deals with my thesis, which is the deviatoric behavior of peat, in particular between past empiricism and future perspective. So I would like to guide you through this presentation in the same way that I arrived to the Netherlands and I started my PhD thesis, which is first of all trying to understand what peat is. I like defining peat as a fine sedimentary fine grain deposit. We have a particular feature, which is a highly abundant organic fraction, which can be leaves, roots, and fiber. Now, if you translate this definition into numbers, we are dealing with a soil which has a porosity of about 90%, extremely compressible, lambda is equal to 2 or even higher, but at the same time, it has an extremely high friction angle, at least 40 degrees. And as you can see here in this micrograph, you can clearly recognize that within the fabric of this soil, there are multiple levels of fibers that can range between few millimeters or few centimeters, as we will see later on. Now, the question now is why did I study peat and why I studied peat in the Netherlands? Well, peat in the Netherlands has a long-lasting tradition. The country is built actually on a soft deltaic deposit, especially on the west side, where we are struggling and dealing with important problems such as land subsidence and several thousand kilometers of infrastructure such as dikes and embankments, highway and motorway that are built on soft soil and in particular on peats. So understanding the geotechnical and engineering behavior of this material is of primary importance for the Netherlands. Now, at this stage, as I started my PhD, I tried to draw a line on what we knew or what we did not know at that time about peat.
Stefano,
And
can you please put your presentation in full screen, please?
sorry. Thank you very much. Now it should be okay. So
Perfect.
what I did here is trying to summarize what we knew and what we did not know about peat. So the first thing is that the pre-failure behavior of this material is normally neglected in the practice. And at the same time, we recognize that several problems come from the presence of the fibers. For example, the fibers give an additional reinforcement to the material, but we don't know or we are not able to quantify how much. At the same time, the fibers are normally supposed to be horizontally aligned and therefore generate or induce some anisotropy on my material. And triaxial tests often are not considered a reliable test to define the shear strength of my material. And then eventually the few modeling attempts for peat are normally coming from previous attempts for soft clays. So the idea is with this PhD teaching tries to do a step forward towards an experimentally based constitutive approach for the deviatoric behavior of peat. Now, when I started my PhD, I had a wonderful opportunity to work on a real case of study. This is an historical 500 years old rural dike. And this dike was available for TU Delft to be brought to failure, as you can see on the right hand side of the screen. But even more importantly, we tried to stress this dike and try to understand what is the pre-failure response of this infrastructure by means of excavating at the toe of the dike, a ditch, and then performing some dewatering. So just a few information, the dike body was extremely heterogeneous, was present, there was some silt, sand, gravel, and clay. But underneath the dike body, there was a foundation layer between 1 and 2.5 meters thick of peat, extremely organic, 90% of organic content. And underneath the peat, there was a clay silt with an organic content of about 5% and 2 meters thick. Now, the first thing that I want to show you is why and how this dike failed. And here we can appreciate the failure mechanism by means of inclinometers at three different locations from the top towards the crest of the dike. As you can see, the failure was propagating as a spreading failure from the toe of the dike and then moved backwards toward the crest of the dike. So from the field measurements, we were able to define that the failure was initiated within the first meter of organic silty clay underneath peat. And this is the first moment of my PhD thesis that I was very disappointed, because I said that I've been embarking on a PhD journey through the behavior of peat, and I ended up on the first year understanding that the real problem of this infrastructure is the organic clay underneath. But not everything was lost, because it is true that the weak element was the organic clay underneath the peat, but what was the triggering mechanism? And this is what I would like to discuss with you. So here we are analyzing the deformation behavior of this block of peat. And in particular, you can clearly see that this block of peat during the dewatering was squeezing vertically, but at the same time, what is most important, there was a very important horizontal bulging. So the idea is that this high compressibility of this peat generates very important lateral displacement that must propagate through the organic silty clay underneath. And how it propagates, we can understand the propagation mechanism by analyzing the kinematic compatibility at the peat and organic silty clay layer interface. This is a sample taken from one of the interfaces between the peat, the dark brown material, and the organic silty clay, the gray material. You can clearly see that there is a sort of frame in between these two materials given by the fibers that are crossing the interface. So if you take into account the deformation mode of the peat, which is bulging laterally, you can clearly imagine that this lateral displacement start propagating inside the interface and reaching the organic silty clay underneath. Now, if you look at the stress strain behavior of these different soil layers, here I plot the results of a direct simple shear test in terms of stress ratio on the vertical axis and shear strain on the horizontal axis. You can clearly see that the peat sample, which is the green line, did not show any sign of failure because the behavior is a continuous strain hardening up to large strain, 15 or 20%. However, at a small strain of about 3 to 5%, both the organic silty clay and the interface material already mobilized their maximum stress ratio. So the reason is that the strong deformability and high deformability of this peat layer propagates the displacement through the organic silt and brought the organic silt to failure. So if I have to draw a roadmap of what we know from the field, for sure the role of the interface between the different foundation layers plays an important role, but at the same time, the pre-failure behavior of peat is extremely important. So if you take into consideration the engineering needs, which is serviceability and safety assessment, you clearly realize that there is a need to have a constitutive and numerical model for describing the behavior of peat. So at this stage, during my PhD thesis, I decided to go back to the lab and performing advanced laboratory tests in order to derive the constitutive ingredients that a simple model for peat should contain. Now, what does it mean dealing with peat at the laboratory scale? It means that the soil is extremely soft and the effective stress in the field is extremely low. So we are dealing with experimental testing at very low confining stress, below 50 kilopascal. At the same time, our sample will experience large strain. And then we need to take into account that we have fibers inside our soil. Now, I want to focus for the central part of the presentation on the laboratory scale. The vast majority of the results, not all, that I will show you today will deal with reconstituted peat sample in order to limit the heterogeneity coming from the presence of big fibers. As you can see here, there is a micro CT scan of the peat. So you clearly see on the white spots inorganic grains and around a diffuse fibrous matrix containing small fibers up to 3 to 5 millimeter long. Some initial assumption and limitation as well of the experimental activity are listed here. So I limit myself in the axis symmetric condition by performing triaxial compression test. So far there is no information on the deviatoric plane for what concerns peat. And in terms of modeling approach, my thesis started with an attempt to use or to exploit an hyperplastic framework in collaboration with Dr. Machine and try and model peat with hypoplasticity. The modeling attempt seems extremely promising. However, I realized that a lot of ingredients, in particular asymptotic states, must be defined from laboratory tests, which means that we need to go at very large strain, and therefore I encounter some limitation in terms of stress and strain inhomogeneities. So what I decided is doing maybe one step backward in terms of innovation, in terms of modeling approach, and using a simple elastoplasticity framework where I had an easier, let's say, link between some experimental data and the constitutive ingredients that I'm going to show you right now. So the first thing that I did when I started my experimental investigation is trying to define what is the shear strength of peat. Now, shear strength of peat is normally tested or investigated in the past by means of triaxial undrained compression test. If you look at the literature, you ended up with friction angle of about 60 or 70 degrees. Now, before entering the discussion, I want to share with you a video which shows you what does it mean dealing with peat in undrained triaxial compression test. I hope you can see the video. So you can see here that the sample is squeezed vertically. And what you can see is that there is a non-uniform deformation mode with a lateral expansion of the lateral side of the sample. Now, if you look at the sample at the end of the test, you clearly realize that there is a non-homogeneous deformation field. And in particular, the rough platens that normally are used in the laboratory investigation causes the formation of what we call dead zone. Now, what does it mean, this non-homogeneous deformation mode in terms of deviatoric stress at failure? Here I presented the results of two series of tests. The first test, I use roughened platens, and I try to increase the height over the diameter ratio of my sample. And the last two tests, I perform the same test by adopting smooth end platens. You can clearly see that accounting for the effects of end restraint, so this dead zone, you tend to overestimate the obligatoric stress at failure. At the same time dealing with under interaction compression test, there is also another problem, which is the measurements of the pore water pressure. Because normally in conventional apparatus, the pore water pressure is measured at the bottom of the sample, so exactly within the dead zone. So if you look at the excess pore water pressure measured at the bottom of the sample for different height to diameter ratio and rough or smooth end platens, you can clearly realize that adopting rough end platens with a standard height to diameter ratio equal to 2, you ended up by overestimating by 7 kilopascal the excess pore water pressure. Now, 7 kilopascal might not be extremely important in our mind, but I would like to point it out that this test was started from a mean effective stress equal to 35 kilopascal. So the uncertainty by having this overestimation in excess pore water pressure are dramatic. And you can also appreciate the benefits of adopting smooth end platens in the distribution of the water content at the end of the test. Here, for example, for a rough test, you can clearly see that the water content at the top and the bottom of the sample are lower than at the center of the sample, which means that despite the external undrained condition, there is an internal water migration from the bottom and the top towards the center of the sample. While by adopting smooth end platens, it seems like that the distribution of the water content is reasonably uniform within the sample. Now, in summary, if you combine these two effects of end restraint, the first one, which is overestimating the deviatoric stress at failure, and the second one, underestimating the mean effective stress by means of overestimating the excess pore water pressure, and you combine these two effects in the ultimate friction angle at the maximum stress ratio, this is what you get, which is a dramatic picture, because using height to diameter ratio equal to 2 with rough end platens, you estimate a friction angle of 55 degrees, which seems in line with what is reported in the literature. But by accounting end restraints effect by means of smooth end platens, the true friction angle of this material is about 42 degrees. So we are introducing an uncertainty of about 13 degrees just by end restraints effects. The second aspect that I want to show you is also the implication of smooth and rough end platens or what concern the compression behavior of peat. Here I presented two simple isotropic compression tests, the gray one with rough end platens and the white dot with smooth end platens. And I would like to draw the attention of the plastic strain increment vectors. So starting from the initial point of the test, you can clearly see that the plastic strain increment vector are downward oriented, which means that there is an initial anisotropy due to the 1D preparation of my sample. But progressively, this inclination of the strain increment vector turns from negative to positive. However, if you look at the inclination of the plastic strain increment vector for what concerns a smooth test, so the white dot, you can clearly see that the plastic strain increment vector starts rotating, and eventually this initial anisotropy is progressively erased and this vector turns to be horizontally aligned. So the adoption of rough end platens introduces a deviatoric strain component over isotropic path, which it does not belong to anisotropy, but is a fictitious ingredient coming from end restraints effect. And the second important thing is also, what is the id locus of this material? In many modeling approach, we need to define what is the transition between a stiff and less stiff response. But up to now, there was no information what can be the trace of the id locus of peat. So I want to propose you a few tests, in particular radial path with multiple loading and unloading step, in order to define what is the yield points for my material. In order to define the yield point is quite subjective. I use different stress and strain spaces and also energy criteria. Now, for example, just to give you an example, I use the first order work over the length of the stress path. And here I estimate my yield point with the red circle, where there is this transition from an initial flat over a progressively increased first order work. So if you do so for every test that we performed, you ended up for the first time to have a trace over the yield locus on the PQ space. So as you can see, it's quite reasonable. It's not as big as the modified conclave, lies slight below the modified conclave. Another important ingredient when we describe the behavior of soil is the hardening mechanism. So how the hardening variable evolves with the plastic strain. So normally, in the common assumption in constitutive model for fine grain material is that the hardening mechanism is purely volumetric, which means that the pre-consolidation pressure evolves only due to volumetric plastic strain. In order to prove this concept or not for peat, I presented here the evolution of the pre-consolidation pressure, so the hardening variable, versus the volumetric plastic strain for four different radial paths, which has an increasing stress ratio. As you can see here, the simple hypothesis of volumetric hardening does not hold for peat, because the steeper the stress path, the higher is the evolution of the hardening variable, which means that the hardening variable for peat does not follow a simple volumetric law. So if you propose a combination, for example, between volumetric plastic strain and deviatoric plastic strain by means of an experimental coefficient D, you clearly see that these four tests align over a straight line. And this is a very important evidence, because for the first time, there is a proof that the hardening mechanism of peat is better described by a volumetric and distortional hardening. And the last ingredient that is missing for a simple elastoplastic model formulation is the plastic potential. So here, once again, I present a series of experimental results, mainly from rough tests, in terms of dilatancy over stress ratio. At the first sight, it looks like that these data seems quite aligned, in the sense that we can draw a first attempt of stress dilatancy relationship. But once again, I was afraid of having some misconception or bias due to end restraints. So what I did is performing a simple K-knot consolidation path. And why did I perform a K-knot consolidation path? Because in theory, the K-knot consolidation path is not affected by end restraints effects, because there is no lateral strain of the sample. Here I present the results both in terms of reconstituted and natural sample. You can clearly see that the lateral pressure ratio, so the ratio between the radial effective stress and the axial stress, tends to align towards a final value of K0 equal to 0.33. Now, 0.33, if we believe in Jackie's relationship, gives as an estimate a friction angle of about 42 degrees. So once again, we confirm in an indirect way what we found from undrained triaxial compression tests with smooth end platings. And thanks to the absence of end restraints effects, I will propose a new stress dilatancy relationship which uses the plastic strain increment vectors coming from this test. And this is how I did it. So the new proposed stress dilatancy relationship should satisfy three conditions. The first is that the dilatancy should be zero at critical state, coming from smooth test. And the second condition is that the experimental dilatancy that I just present you from K-knot consolidation path must be without any end restraints effects. And then eventually that the dilatancy must go to infinity when the stress path approaches isotropic compression. So by using a flexible equation, by using, for example, a shape coefficient Kg, this is the proposed stress dilatancy relationship. It is interesting to notice how this stress dilatancy relationship is compared to rough test. So for stress ratio below the K0, end restraints effect tends to underestimate the true dilatancy, while for stress ratio above K0, end restraints effects tend to overestimate the dilatancy of my material. So at this stage, we have all the ingredients, or the most important ingredients, that we can use in a simple elastoplastic constitutive model for peat. So So the last part of the presentation deals with the simulation of the laboratory test. And in particular, in order to overcome the limitation of end restraints, what we have done it is implemented a constitutive model into a finite element code and performing laboratory test and modeling laboratory test as a boundary value problem. Here I listed the ingredients that we use in the model, the hypoelastic low weight constant Poisson ratio, which is an approximation, the yield locus and the flow rule according to the experimental results that I've used, and the hardening law proposed by Nova et al. From the 1977, which is a mix between volumetric and distortional hardening. I use also a saturating law in order to limit the dilation at failure. And I want to compare the model capabilities with the experimental results. So the first thing that I did is comparing the model capability with some drain triaxial compression test with multiple loading and unloading path. Here you can see the response of the model seems quite nice because in terms of volumetric strain versus mean effective stress, the model was able to capture both qualitatively and quantitatively the experimental results. And this agreement was also found in terms of deviatoric stress-strain response. And the nice thing is that this agreement seems to be reasonable also for a wide range of axial strain, up to 20%, which for sure contain the vast majority of application of infrastructure on PEET, as we saw before. So at this stage, I was quite happy with the work that I've done it. So I tried also to simulate some undrained triaxial compression test with this model. And this is the results, or one of the results. And this is the second moment of my PhD thesis that I was very disappointed. Because if you are generous, you can say that this model is not so bad. But if you look carefully, there are clearly some limitations in the model because just focus, for example, on the prediction in terms of excess per water pressure. The model predicts an incorrect excess per water pressure for the entire pre-failure domain, which is somehow extremely important for us because we pay a lot of attention on the pre-failure response of PEET. So once again, there was something missing that I did not account for or I did not explore in the lab. So I did one step back again and went back to the lab and trying to investigate something more behind this discrepancy. And what I propose you now is a comparison between two series of tests. The first test is the SM1 test, which is a stress control drain compression test, which follows this stress path. And the other two tests, the one is undrained and the other one is drained, but they share the same stress history and same loading direction. And I want to compare with you the inclination of the plastic strain increment vector in correspondence to this stress state. As you can see, there are two different directions of inclination of this vector, because the two samples that follow the same stress history and the same loading direction, they have the same inclination of plastic strain increment vector, but the other test, which comes from a completely different stress history and loading direction, indeed show a different inclination. And if you consider the entire stress dilatancy relationship, this was the initial stress strain dilatancy that I proposed based on the K-naught test. And these are the data from these two tests that are aligned on the same loading direction. So you can clearly see that the experimental data are well below the proposed stress strain dilatancy, which means that is the reason why the model, as it was before, was not able to reproduce a simple undrained triaxial compression test. So there is indeed an evidence of an incremental response depending on the previous stress history and the loading direction. However, what is the physical reason behind this dependence? In my opinion, the physical reason is related to the role of the small fibers. As I said before, this PEET was containing fibers up to 5 mm. So what I did here, I present the same results. Instead of stress path, I use strain path. So we have axial strain in the vertical axis and radial strain in the horizontal axis. And on the right-hand side of the slide, I tried to draw a simple conceptual sketch and trying to visualize how this randomly distributed fibrous network can play according to the different stress path. So we can assume and imagine that for stress paths that cause compressive radial strain, so we are in this domain, for example, isotropic compression and, as a case limit, 1D compression, the fibers basically are switched off because there is no fibers realignment and stretching because all the sample is compressed radially. However, for stress path which causes expansive radial strain, such as the isochoric test, so the Andrain triaxial compression test, in this situation, the effects of the fiber is magnified because the deformation of the sample promotes fibers realignment and stretching. And to conclude this presentation, there is an additional part which is missing is, what about natural pit sample? So natural pit sample, they are slightly different from reconstituted pit sample in the sense that the fabric of this natural sample not only contain a small diffuse fibers, as you can see here, but they also contain big fibers, which length can be of about 3 centimeters. So the idea is how good the model that I propose perform when we are dealing with natural pit sample. Here I present the comparison with the same model that I showed you before in terms of normalized Q and P dash. So you can clearly see that experimental data overpass a phase transition line and the stress path tends to reach the tension cutoff line. So zero lateral effective confining stress. The model prediction seems not to be so bad, but once again, if you look at the results in terms of excess pore water pressure, there is something wrong again, because the model predicts an excess pore water pressure which is decreasing at large strain. But on the contrary, if you look at the experimental results, clearly the excess pore water pressure is still increasing. So to capture the behavior also of natural pit sample, I try to do something more, or starting from the model that I used before, adding an additional ingredient, which is mutuated from the extensive work done in Bristol, for example, from Diambra and co-worker on fiber reinforced sands. So the idea is that natural pit sample could be modeled as a composite material. So we have an initial contribution, which is given by the small fibrous network within the pit matrix, so the S1 system. And for this contribution, we use the previous model. But at the same time, we need to include an additional contribution, which comes from the additional reinforcement provided by the big fibers. And for this one, a simplified approach can be that the fibers act as a truss, with an axial stiffness of 1 MPa coming from some experimental evidence. The only additional thing is taking into account the possibility of slippage between the fibers and the matrix through a contact efficiency coefficient proposed by Diambra et al. In 2030. And this is the results of the new updated model. Now, if you look on the left-hand side, there is already one important thing because the results are expressed in terms of matrix and composite material. So you can clearly see that the matrix already reached the critical state and is approaching after a small dilation towards critical state. And for the matrix, we use true friction angle because it's about 42 degrees. But the composite material reaches much higher shear strength due to the additional contribution of the fibers. At the same time, if you look at the development of the excess pore water pressure, you can clearly see now the benefit of this modeling approach, because while the matrix is dilating, the additional reinforcement of the fibers causes contractive overall behavior and therefore a positive excess pore water pressure still increasing. So this slide brings me to the conclusion of my presentation. If I started the presentation stating what we knew and what did not know about peat, now the question is, what do we know now about peat? For sure, we know that the pre-failure behavior is crucial for every field application where peat serves as a foundation layer. And we advanced the modeling, the understanding of the behavior of peat matrix with small fibers. First of all, we eliminate the misconception of this exceptional friction angle that we find in the literature. It is very high, but not as 60 or 70 degrees. It's about 40 to 45 degrees. At the same time, the results clearly show that there is an induced anisotropy coming from the small fibers, and this anisotropy depends on the previous stress and strain history. And two ingredients that can be used and must be included in an elastoplastic formulation for this kind of material is non-associated plasticity, and even more importantly, deviatoric hardening. For what concerns natural peat with big fibers, the thesis proposes a simple approach, which is at the preliminary level, which seems to be promising, and it is modeling natural peat sample as a composite material. And also, the thesis wants to highlight the importance of end restraints on soft soil, something that was thoroughly investigated in the 16th and the 17th, then it was a bit abandoned for peat, and now it starts becoming extremely important because it can significantly bias the observed behavior. Now, the next question is, what is still missing? Of course, there are some parts that I did not include in my PhD thesis, for example, the behavior of peat in extension. At the same time, a big limitation is what is the deviatoric space for this material? And eventually, what is, for my opinion, the bottleneck of this material is performing or supporting constitutive modeling with some micromechanical studies, for example, on the evolution of the fibrous network upon different loading direction. And last, I would like to try to draw a perspective, in my opinion, for soft soil testing. We should try to overcome the concept of element testing as a perfect soil element test, but we should talk more appropriately as an advanced sample testing that must be combined, for example, with an inverse analysis in trying to bridge the gap from what is the sample behavior and what is the true material behavior. So the last slide is just the acknowledgement. I would like to thank the Dutch Organization for Scientific Research for supporting my PhD at UDelft and a series of people that contributed the most during my stay at UDelft. Many thanks for your attention.
Thank you so much. Thank you. It's a pity that clapping online is not as nice as right, but I think you got some claps.
Thank you very much.
I thank you for being almost on time. It was a bit longer than expected, but it was absolutely nice. I think that the floor is open for question if there is any. So either you write your question in the chat, or you just raise your, or you just say, or just talk. Perhaps if you are asking a question, you should remember to unmute your micro before. Any question for Stefano? Chris, please.
Wonderful presentation, just really great, beautiful work, Stefano. But I wonder, so actually we've seen similar effects in very ductile rock materials, and I wondered whether you'd actually tried lubricating the pistons in your experiments. So simply having the sample in contact with a smooth piston, of course, does not necessarily remove all the friction effects. I just wondered, did you actually go a step further and see what happens if you introduce some really slippery material at the end?
Thank you very much. Yes, indeed. So the main limitation that I considered during the study is the friction with the porous stone that are basically confined in the sample.
Yeah.
And that one can be reduced if not removed. But another important limitation for this material is the restraint that comes from the O-ring and the membrane that is surrounding the sample.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that is up to now extremely difficult to limit. So that because we can adopt large and smooth platens, but still the membranes will follow the platens and will be in contact with
the sample. Yeah, yeah.
So that is, in my opinion, the still another bottleneck if you want to go towards the perfect test. But I have to say that probably the solution must be in between. So trying to reduce as much as possible what we can without following the perfect test, and trying maybe to increase our capability of measuring something, for example, and trying to back analyze the response. So it should be a compromise of the two things.
Yeah. Now I think that's right. You need to actually model the behavior of the sample in an experiment and back it out that way. Yeah. Very, very good. A beautiful, beautiful work. Well done.
Thank you very much.
Chico, your mic is off.
Claudio, you have the, please.
Yes, thank you. It's just a curiosity related to something you wrote in one of your last slides, when saying one of the issues which will have to be addressed in the future is the proper choice of the deviatoric space. And I wanted you to comment a little bit on that and expand a little bit what you have in mind concerning the choice of the deviatoric space.
Yes, absolutely right. Basically, as I said before, I confine myself in the axisymmetric condition. And by implementing the constitutive model into a finite element code and performing some boundary value problem, I have to make an hypothesis on the shape of the flow rule on the plastic potential on the deviatoric space. I use, for example, a Van Eckenen shape. However, the main problem comes from the fact that when we encounter problems in the field with PIT, we are not axisymmetric conditions. So we play, for example, between plane strain. So what is the shear strength for this material under plane strain condition, and how we can describe this transition between axisymmetric and plane strain? There is some attempt going on at TU Delft with Professor Mollenkamp, and trying to have an axial shear apparatus which can characterize the shape of the plastic potential in the deviatoric space. And that is the, let's say, an advancement that should be done in order to improve our model capabilities and description for this material.
If I'm allowed, I have a follow-up question that is essentially following what Claudio. This is one of the things I was thinking during your presentation, Stefano. At some point you were describing very well with a cartoon what happens in those parts in which the fibers tend to realign, and those parts in which the fibers essentially stay as random as they were to start with. But then I was telling to myself, Jesus, this is one of those cases, one of those materials for which we should remember that there is a third invariant in at play. In other terms, all your QP plots are nice, but we know that the space is a space, it's not a plane. And I think that for this material, besides the shear strength, that is the thing that you were mentioning, but in general, I would love to test this material in a true triaxial, for example. Have you thought any thought about it? Any possibility to do that? Any plan to do that?
I totally agree, and I wish I could. What I thought in the past was the true triaxial can be absolutely. I was thinking a bit the hollow cylinder, but then I abandoned, not because if I have or not have the machine, but mainly for the difficulty in preparing a sample, especially for, and also because if we have also to understand that the fibers play a role in the size of the sample. So how representative are the fibers compared to the volume of the sample? If the hollow cylinder thickness is about 2 centimeters, for example, a fibers can be 2 centimeters long, then we are basically, we have a problem in the representativeness of my sample. So a true triaxial can be, it would be nice if I could now. So I'm totally open to move towards this next step, either with a true triaxial, with an axial shear apparatus that they are currently developing here. So that is truly a bottleneck also for what concerns the development of the modeling. Also because the fibers normally in the past they used to move towards a sort of abandoning the triaxial test and performing direct simple shear because they assume that the fibers are horizontally aligned and therefore we do not stretch the fibers during a simple shear. But recent videos and CT scan, they clearly see that the fibers are almost randomly distributed in this natural material. So even though we perform a simple shear test, we ended up by stretching the fibers. And there are some videos that they see, we can see that the fibers either they pull out from the matrix. So there is a fibers contribution also in direct simple shear test.
Yeah, you might consider talking to, I see that you were mentioning at some point, Andrea D'Ambra and the group in Bristol. They're one of the few places in which they have more than one true triaxial. You might consider challenging them to help you on that. Yes. I also wanted to make just a remark, but I think I like particularly your talk. That was very, very inspiring. And I think there was something that is true, that you were showing things that were pretty much known and studied and published in the 60s. So references that I remember as a PhD student, and then people just forgot. So I think that you gave a clear illustration of what advanced experimental work is in our field. It's not only about using fancy tools, tomography, just to mention the obvious one, but also it's a matter of being rigorous. And I think that in that respect, so the end restraints is a minor detail with major effects. And I think in this respect, your examples were really very, very well chosen and extremely interesting to, especially to the young. I mean, you don't need to be fancy to do good experiments. You just need to think and to pay attention to details. That's the message. Is there any other question? Well, I think we're doing okay. We're still 6 minutes on the. Well, Stefano, you should please go open your email account. I sent you an email during your talk.
Okay. Yes.
It's in Italian, so please don't show it to the public. There is no insult, it's just an email, but...
I'm downloading the attachment.
Okay, you can open the attachment, then I'm trying to share... I'm going to share my screen.
Okay, thank you very much.
If I can do it, okay. Do you see my screen?
Mm-hmm. Yes. No, not yet. Sorry. Now, yes.
Yes.
So this file is a very precious one. It's the one that Stefano got through the email. It's the one that, in general, I give in person to Stefano. is the little piece of paper in A4 format that I was mentioning before. I happen to go to universities in the States. At Georgia Tech, you go to visit Dr. Chloe Arson, and you find a similar paper in her office. Then you go to Northwestern and you visit Giuseppe Buscarnera, and you find a similar one. Etc. So, you know, this is, I think, an important recognition, and I'm very happy that I was the one signing this for you. Congratulations again, Stefan.
Thank you very much. Truly a pleasure and an honor to receive such a prize, really.
Okay, if I can now add, I have to stop this. Okay, I was able to stop. I think that this part of the ceremony ends here. There is one person that I didn't mention, and I want to mention her now. That's Cristina Iommi. I don't know whether Cristina is with us.
Cristina is probably teaching now. She told me that she had a class exactly
anyway,
at the end.
I'm not doing that for her, but I'm doing that because I think that she deserves. Every time we give a prize to a doctor, of course it's your work, Stefano, but I think that the supervisor plays a role, and in this particular case, your supervisor, you say promoter or whatever in the Netherlands. So I think that Cristina should be acknowledged, because I think that she did a very good job in being with you during the journey, in sharing the moment of deception and disappointment, and also the moment of excitement during your journey. So I think that Cristina should be mentioned for that. She deserved it, and I'm very happy about it.